We have an exciting panel discussion here, and I'm looking forward to getting this started. This is the book session of the morning. The afternoon is the media and film and music session, so both are kind of bookends to this story today. A little over a year ago, my colleague Chantal, Oudraat, and I came up with this idea. Wouldn't it be great if we could do some kind of transatlantic collaboration and have it around the 10th anniversary of what is now, I hope, something you know a lot about, the United Nations Security Council resolution on women, peace, and security. And so we began, and we were very lucky to come up with what we think has been a dream team of collaborators, because really in just a little over 1 year, we went from idea to review to, if you haven't seen it, the book. So I have to really thank all of my collaborators here today, some who've come a long ways to be with us. This is how we're going to run it this morning. I've asked each of the contributors to the book just to give you one or two key points, takeaway messages, so that you have like a Reader's Digest version of the book and can really start to sort these things out. And then I've asked two of our really good colleagues, now one with USAID and one here in USIP, to be our discussants, people who have been on the ground in conflict and really have an eye for these issues. So without any further delay, I'm going to introduce each of the presenters one by one. They're going to keep their remarks, they promised me, to about 3 minutes, so there's lots of time for Q&A. And I run a pretty tight ship, so if they start seeing me wave, they'll know what I mean. So I'd like to introduce to you Chantal Oudraat. She is the head of our JR fellowship program here at USIP. And her bio, and as with all of our presenters, their complete bio, are with you. So I'm going to keep my introductions extremely short so we can hear stuff. So Chantal, to you.
Thank you, Kathleen. Before I make a few remarks, and I might take just a few more than 3 minutes. Being one of the editors, I take that prerogative. I would like to thank you and my other co-editor, Helga, as well as the authors of the book. You know, edited volumes are really great to do because they allow you to bring together very different perspectives between two covers. But that is also, of course, the hard part of edited books. But I must say that this book was really an exception. And not just because we had great authors, we had, but also I think that everybody understood that we were really at a key moment. We were really at a juncture where the women, peace, and security agenda could either move forward, linger, or even slide backwards. And that with this book and with the cooperation between PRIO and USIP, we could maybe help move this agenda forward. Now, I think if we look in the future, there are really some challenges and opportunities. In terms of the challenges, I see the challenges are sort of threefold. First is the fact that since 1995 and since the first World Conference on Women that actually paid attention to the issue of women in security issues, since the adoption of Resolution 1325, now 11 years ago, little progress has been made, and Ambassador Stroman mentioned this yesterday. Dawn, you mentioned this today. And I would even argue that actually right after the adoption of 1325, we really did backslide, and 9/11, I think, had something to do with that. Second challenge, I think, is that there seems to me a little bit of a generational and disciplinary divide. It seems to me that young men and women particularly in the US and Europe, do not really seem attuned to these issues anymore. For the most part, they believe that gender equality has been attained. And on the disciplinary side, gender issues remain very much in a ghetto in sort of women's studies, gender studies, etc. They are still very marginal in the security studies field, or more generally, the international relations field. And then third, the challenge is that there's, of course, huge difference between the situation of women in the developing world and those in the developed world. Now, despite these challenges, I think we're also at a moment where we have huge opportunities. First is the changed nature, of violent conflict. And Kathleen Hicks talked about that this morning. Most violent conflicts these days are about identity issues. They involve civilians, both as perpetrators as well as victims. And I think it has led international actors as well as the military to rethink how we respond to these challenges. I also think it has led to the belief that most wars today are not won through kinetic power, but through hearts and minds, through concrete actions that actually make people's lives better. Second huge opportunity, I think, is the political climate that has changed really in the last 2 years. Hillary Clinton was the keynote speaker in the Beijing conference in 1995. In 2009, she became the US Secretary of State. And I think she has really seized the power of her position to move this agenda forward. Hillary Clinton is not paying lip service to these issues. She has a long, very solid track record in this. And as Don mentioned earlier, we actually have now at the US government in leadership positions people who really are wanting to push this agenda forward. Internationally, too, I think the situation has changed, and we're in a moment of opportunity. The anniversary of 1325 has led to the establishment of UN Women, this big UN agency. That is now mandated to push this agenda forward. Third, I think the third opportunity is that, yes, of course, wars are horrible acts. They change the fabrics of society. But wars and conflicts often also change the dynamics, the power dynamics in society. And we have seen that, be it in Liberia or even Afghanistan. And I think seizing those changes and those new dynamics in conflict countries may possibly entail some risks, but also has, I think, huge potential benefits. And I think international actors have started to see that there might actually be some benefits in change rather than stability, and that women in this regard are a powerful force. So to make a long story short, timing and momentum is everything. I think we have the momentum now, but we're all responsible for seizing the opportunities and not squandering them in this next decade of 1325. I want to make two other brief points. The second point I want to make has to do with the importance of research. Whenever we meet policymakers, including Milan Verweer, she says, we need more data, we need more research. The problem is that we have a lot of anecdotes, but very little systematic data and facts. Rigorous research programs on these issues are at an infancy stage. And one of our partners, George Washington University, is currently undertaking a review of research and reports published in the last two decades. And its primary conclusion is that while many of these reports have helped raise awareness, they have come with little systematic data and systematic research protocols. So I think that is a challenge. And to follow up on what Dawn told us earlier this morning, follow the buck. Well, in this area as well, follow the buck if we are really serious about this issue, we need to put more money into research. Third, leadership. We've talked a lot about leadership. And we've talked also, I think, within the community, and in particular the gender community, a lot about the importance of grassroots, the importance of the involvement of communities, etc. And I think while the involvement of local organizations is important, support at the leadership level is really key. Because only with support at the leadership level are you able to bring this into the DNA of structures and organizations. Finally, final word, a plea for vigilance. First, and again, maybe echoing what Ambassador Strumman said yesterday, we need to make sure that we're serious about the protection agenda and that this agenda gets implemented. Rape is just inadmissible. It is a crime. And I think we will hear more about this issue from Inger. Second, I think we need to become more serious about the power agenda. We have to remain vigilant despite what has been said, both by Secretary Clinton, by Don Steinberg, by Kathleen Hicks, that the rights of women in Afghanistan are not being swept under the rug in a general peace deal with the Taliban. And we need to be vigilant and provide support to the women in the Middle East. And maybe my colleague Manal will say something about that later in the panel. So with that, I'll turn it over to you.
Thank you so much. I'm going to turn to our co-editor, Helga Hernes. Helga is the senior advisor on women, peace, and